चैप्टर नंबर 14 एनवायरमेंटल केमिस्ट्री का पार्ट टू का रीडिंग का वीडियो है ये। इसी चैप्टर का हिंदी में एक्सप्लेनेशन के वीडियोस ऑलरेडी अपलोड किए हुए हैं, आप प्लेलिस्ट में जाके उन्हें चेक कर सकते हैं। 14.3 वाटर पोल्यूशन। वाटर इज असेंशियल फॉर लाइफ। विदाउट वाटर देर वुड बी नो लाइफ। वी यूजुअली टेक वाटर एज ग्रांटेड फॉर इट्स प्योरिटी, बट वी मस्ट एंश्योर द क्वालिटी ऑफ वाटर। पोल्यूशन ऑफ वाटर ओरिजिनेट्स फ्रॉम ह्यूमन एक्टिविटीज़। Through different paths, pollution reach surface or groundwater. Easily identified source or place of pollution is called as point source. For example, municipal and industrial discharge pipes where pollutants enter the water source. Known point sources of pollution are those where a source of pollution cannot be easily identified. For example, agricultural runoff in bracket from farm, animals and croplands, acid rain, storm water drainage in bracket from streets, parking lots and lawns, etc. Table 14.1 lists the major water pollutants and their sources. 14.3.1 causes of water pollution. First, pathogens. The most serious water pollutants are the disease-causing agents called pathogens. Pathogens include bacteria and other organisms that enter water from domestic sewage and animal excreta. Human excreta contain bacteria such as Escherichia coli and Streptococcus faecalis, which cause gastrointestinal diseases. Second, organic waste. The other major water pollutant is organic matter such as leaves, grass, trees, etc. They pollute water as a consequence of runoff. Excessive phytoplankton growth within water is also cause of water pollution. This waste are biodegradable. The large population of bacteria decomposes organic matter present in water. They consume oxygen dissolved in water. The amount of oxygen that water can hold in the solution is limited. In cold water, dissolved oxygen in bracket DO can reach a concentration up to 10 ppm, that is parts per million. Whereas oxygen in air is about 2 lakh parts per million. That is why even a moderate amount of organic matter when it decomposes in water can deplete the water of its dissolved oxygen. The concentration of dissolved oxygen in water is very important for aquatic life. If the concentration of dissolved oxygen of water is below 6 ppm, the growth of fish gets inhibited. Oxygen reaches water either through atmosphere or from the process of photosynthesis carried out by many aquatic green plants during daylight. However, during night, photosynthesis stops but the plants continue to respire, resulting in reduction of dissolved oxygen. The dissolved oxygen is also used by microorganisms to oxidize organic matter. If too much of organic matter is added to water, all the available oxygen is used up. This causes oxygen-dependent aquatic life to die. Thus, anaerobic bacteria in bracket which do not require oxygen begin to break down the organic waste and produce chemicals that have a foul smell and are harmful to human health. Aerobic in bracket oxygen-requiring bacteria degrade this organic waste and keep the water depleted in dissolved oxygen. Thus, the amount of oxygen required by bacteria to break down the organic matter present in a certain volume of a sample of water is called biochemical oxygen demand, in bracket BOD. The amount of BOD in the water is a measure of the amount of organic material in the water in terms of how much oxygen will be required to break it down biologically. Clean water would have BOD value of less than 5 ppm, whereas highly polluted water could have a BOD value of 17 ppm or more. Third, chemical pollutants. As we know that water is an excellent solvent, water-soluble inorganic chemicals that include heavy metals such as cadmium, mercury, nickel, etc. constitute an important class of pollutants. All these metals are dangerous to humans because our body cannot excrete them. Over the time, it crosses the tolerance limit. These metals then can damage kidneys, central nervous system, liver, etc. Acids, in bracket like sulfuric acid, from mine drainage and salts from many different sources including raw salt used to melt snow and ice in the colder climates, in bracket sodium and calcium chloride are water-soluble chemical pollutants. The organic chemicals are another group of substances that are found in polluted water. Petroleum products pollute many sources of water. For example, major oil spills in oceans. Other organic substances with serious impacts are the pesticides that drift down the sprays or runoff from plants. Various industrial chemicals like polychlorinated biphenyls in bracket PCBs, which are used as cleansing solvent, detergents and fertilizers, add to the list of water pollutants. PCBs are suspected to be carcinogenics. Nowadays, most of the detergents available are biodegradable. However, their use can create other problems. The bacteria responsible for degrading biodegradable detergent feed on it and grow rapidly. While growing, they may use up all the oxygen dissolved in water. The lack of oxygen kills all other forms of aquatic life such as fish and plants. Fertilizers contain phosphates as additives. The addition of phosphates in water enhances algae growth. Such profuse growth of algae covers the water surface and reduces the oxygen concentration in water. This leads to anaerobic conditions commonly with accumulation of abnoseous decay and animal death. Thus, bloom-infested water inhibits the growth of other living organisms in the water body. This process, in which nutrient-enriched water bodies support a dense plant population which kills animal life by depriving it of oxygen and results in subsequent loss of biodiversity, is known as eutrophication. 14.3.2 International Standards for Drinking Water. The international standards for drinking water are given below and they must be followed. Fluoride. For drinking purposes, water should be tested for fluoride ion concentration. Its deficiency in drinking water is harmful to man and causes diseases such as tooth decay, etc. Soluble fluoride is often added to drinking water to bring its concentration up to 1 ppm or 1 mg per decimeter cube. The fluoride minus ion make the enamel on teeth much harder by converting hydroxyapatite in bracket 3Ca3PO4 twice into CaOH twice, the enamel of on the surface of the teeth into much harder fluorapatite, comma in bracket 3Ca3PO4 twice into CaF2. However, F minus ion concentration above 2 ppm causes brown mottling of teeth. At the same time, excess fluoride in bracket over 10 ppm causes harmful effect to bones and teeth as reported from some parts of Rajasthan. Lead. Drinking water gets contaminated with lead when lead pipes are used for transportation of water. The prescribed upper limit concentration of lead in drinking water is about 50 ppb. Lead can damage kidney, liver, reproductive system, etc. Sulfate. Excessive sulfate in bracket greater than 500 ppm in drinking water causes laxative effect. Otherwise, at moderate levels, it is harmless. Nitrate. The maximum limit of nitrate in drinking water is 50 ppm. Excess nitrate in drinking water can cause disease such as methemoglobinemia in bracket blue baby syndrome. Other metals. The maximum concentration of some common metals recommended in drinking water are given in table 14.2. Activity 2. You can visit local water sources and observe if the river or lake or tank or pond are unpolluted or slightly polluted or moderately polluted or severely polluted by looking at water or by checking pH of water. Document the name of the river and the nearby urban or industrial site from where the pollution is generated. Inform about this to Pollution Control Board's office set up by the government to measure pollution levels. Ensure that appropriate action is taken. You can write the press also. Do not dump waste into household or industrial drain which can enter directly to any water body such as river, pond, stream or lake. Use compost instead of chemical fertilizers in gardens. Avoid the use of pesticides like DDT, malathion, etc. at home and try to use dried neem leaves to help keep insects away. Add a few crystals of potassium permanganate or bleaching powder to the water tank of your house. 14.4 Soil pollution. India, being an agricultural based economy, gives high priority to agriculture, fisheries and livestock development. The surplus production is stored by governmental and non-governmental organizations for the lean season. The food loss during the storage also needs special attention. Have you ever seen the damages caused to the crops, food items by insects, rodents, weeds and crop diseases, etc.? How can we protect them? You are acquainted with some insecticides and pesticides for protection of our crops. However, these insecticides, pesticides and herbicides cause soil pollution. Hence, there is a need for their judicious use. 14.4.1 Pesticides. Prior to World War II, many naturally occurring chemicals such as nicotine in bracket by planting tobacco plants in the crop field were used as pest controlling substance for major crops in agricultural practices. During World War II, DDT was found to be of great use in the control of malaria and other insect-borne diseases. Therefore, after the war, DDT was put to use in agriculture to control the damages caused by insects, rodents, weeds, and various crop diseases. However, due to adverse effects, its use has been banned in India. Pesticides are basically synthetic toxic chemicals with ecological repercussions. The repeated use of the same or similar pesticides give rise to pests that are resistant to that group of pesticides, thus making the pesticides ineffective. Therefore, as insect resistance of DDT increase, other organic toxins such as aldrin and dieldrin were introduced in the market by pesticide industry. Most of the organic toxins are water insoluble and non-biodegradable. These high persistent toxins are therefore transferred from lower trophic level to higher trophic level through food chain, in bracket figure 14.3. Over the time, the concentration of toxins in higher animals reach a level which causes serious metabolic and physiological disorders. In response to high persistence of chlorinated organic toxins, a new series of less persistent or more biodegradable products called organophosphates and carbamates have been introduced in the market. But these chemicals are severe neurotoxins and hence more harmful to humans. As a result, there are reports of some pesticide-related deaths of agricultural field workers. Insects have become resistant to these insecticides also. The insecticide industry is engaged in developing new groups of insecticides. But one has to think, is this the only solution to pest menace? These days, the pesticide industry has shifted its attention to herbicides such as sodium chlorate in bracket NaClO3, sodium arsenide in bracket Na3AsO3 and many others. During the first half of the last century, the shift from mechanical to chemical weed control had provided the industry with flourishing economic market. But one must remember that these are also not environment friendly. Most herbicides are toxic to mammals but are not as persistent as organochlorides. These chemicals decompose in a few months like organochlorides. These too become concentrated in the food web. Some herbicides cause birth defects. Studies show that cornfields sprayed with herbicides are more prone to insect attack and plant disease than fields that are weeded manually. Pesticide and herbicide represent only a very small portion of widespread chemical pollution. A large number of other compounds that are used regularly in chemical and industrial processes for manufacturing activities are finally released in the atmosphere in one or other form. 14.5 Industrial waste. Industrial solid waste are also sorted out as biodegradable and non-biodegradable waste. Biodegradable waste are generated by cotton mills, food processing units, paper mills and textile factories. Non-biodegradable waste are generated by thermal power plants which produce fly ash, integrated iron and steel plants which produce blast furnace slag and steel melting slag. Industries manufacturing aluminium, zinc and copper produce mud and tailings. Fertilizer industries produce gypsum. Hazardous waste such as inflammables, composite explosives or highly reactive substances are produced by industries dealing in metals, chemicals, drugs, pharmaceuticals, dyes, pesticides, rubber goods, etc. The disposal of non-biodegradable industrial solid waste, if not done by a proper and suitable method, may cause serious threat to the environment. New innovations have led to different uses of waste material. Nowadays, fly ash and slag from the steel industry are utilized by the cement industry. Large quantities of toxic waste are usually destroyed by controlled incineration, whereas small quantities are burnt along with factory garbage in open bins. Moreover, solid waste, if not managed effectively, affect the components of the environment. Do you know about waste recycling? Fuel obtained from plastic waste has high octane rating. It contains no lead and is known as green fuel. Due to recent developments made in chemical and textile industries, clothes will be made from recycled plastic waste. This will be available soon in the global textile market. In India, our cities and towns face endless hours of power cut. We can also see piles of rotting garbage here and there. There is a good news that we can get rid from both these problems simultaneously. Technology has now been developed to produce electricity from the garbage. A pilot plant has been set up where, after removing ferrous metals, plastic, glass, paper, etc. from garbage, it is mixed with water. It is then cultured with bacterial species for producing methane, commonly known as biogas. The remaining product is used as manure and biogas is used to produce electricity. 14.6 Strategies to control environmental pollution. After studying air, water, soil and industrial waste pollution in this unit, by now you must have started feeling that the need of controlling environmental pollution. How can you save your immediate environment? Think of the steps or activities which you would like to undertake for controlling air, water, soil and industrial waste pollution in your neighborhood. Here an idea about the strategies for the management of waste is given. 14.6.1 Waste management. Solid waste is not the only waste which you see in your household garbage box. Besides household discards, there are medical, agricultural, industrial and mining wastes. The improper disposal of waste is one of the major causes of environmental degradation. Therefore, the management of waste is of utmost importance. Collection and disposal. Domestic waste are collected in small bins which are then transferred to community bins by private or municipal workers. From these community bins, these are collected and carried to the disposable site. At the site, garbage is sorted out and separated into biodegradable and non-biodegradable materials. Non-biodegradable materials such as plastic, glass, metal scraps, etc. are sent for recycling. Biodegradable waste are deposited in landfills and are converted into compost. The waste, if not collected in garbage bins, finds its way into sewers. Some of it is eaten by cattle. Non-biodegradable waste like polythene bag, metal scraps, etc. chock the sewers and cause inconvenience. Polythene bags, if swallowed by cattle, can cause their lives also. As a normal practice, therefore, all domestic wastes should be properly collected and disposed. The poor management causes health problems leading to epidemics due to contamination of groundwater. It is especially hazardous for those who are in direct contact with the waste, such as rag pickers and workers involved in waste disposal, as they are the ones who handle waste materials mostly without protective device, such as gloves or waterproof boots and gas mask. What can you do for them? Green chemistry. 14.7.1 Introduction. It is well-known fact that self-sufficiency in food has been achieved in India since late 20th century by using fertilizers and pesticides and exploring improved methods and farming, good quality seeds, irrigation, etc. But over-exploitation of soil and excessive use of fertilizers and pesticides have resulted in the deterioration of soil, water and air. The solution of this problem does not lie in stopping the process of development that has been set in, but to discover methods which would help in the reduction of deterioration of the environment. Green chemistry is a way of thinking and is about utilizing the existing knowledge and principles of chemistry and other science to reduce the adverse impact on the environment. Green chemistry is a production process that would bring about minimum pollution or deterioration to the environment. The byproduct generated during a process, if not used gainfully, add to the environmental pollution. Such processes are not only environmental unfriendly but also cost ineffective. The waste generation and its disposal both are economically unsound. Utilization of existing knowledge base for reducing the chemical hazards along with the developmental activities is the foundation of green chemistry. Have you perceived the idea of green chemistry? It is well known that organic solvents such as benzene, toluene, carbon tetrachloride, etc. are highly toxic. One should be careful while using them. As you know, a chemical reaction involves reactants attacking reagents and the medium in which the reaction takes place. Extent of any reaction depends upon physical parameters like temperature, pressure, and use of catalyst. In a chemical reaction, if reactants are fully converted into useful environmental friendly products by using an environmental friendly medium, then there would be no chemical pollutants introduced in the environment. During a synthesis, care must be taken to choose starting materials that can be converted into end product with yield approximately up to 100%. This can be achieved by arriving at optimum conditions of synthesis. It may be worthwhile to carry out synthetic reactions in aqueous medium since water has high specific heat and low volatility. Water is cost effective, non-inflammable and devoid of any carcinogenic effects. Nobel goes to green chemist. Yves Chauvin, Institute of Francais du Pétrole, Rueil, Malmaison, France, Robert H. Grubbs, California Institute of Technology, Caltech, Pasadena, CA, USA, and Richard R. Schock, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, Cambridge, MA, USA, won the 2005 Nobel Prize in Chemistry for work that reduces hazardous waste in creating new chemicals. This all are maybe in French language, so pronunciation is quite different. I'm reading in, you know, in general terms. So the trio won the award for the development of the metathesis method in organic synthesis, a way to rearrange groups of atoms within molecule that the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences likened to a dance in which couples change partners. The metathesis has tremendous commercial potential in the pharmaceuticals, biotechnology and foodstuffs production industries. It is also used in the development of revolutionary environmentally friendlier polymers. This represents a great step forward for green chemistry, reducing potentially hazardous waste through smarter production. Metathesis is an example of how important application of basic science is for the benefit of man, society and the environment. 14.7.2 Green chemistry in day-to-day life. First, dry cleaning of clothes. Tetrachloroethene in bracket Cl2C(CCl2) was earlier used as solvent for dry cleaning. The compound contaminates the groundwater and is also a suspected carcinogen. The process using this compound is now being replaced by a process where liquefied carbon dioxide with a suitable detergent is used. Replacement of halogenated solvent by liquid CO2 will result in less harm to groundwater. These days, hydrogen peroxide in bracket H2O2 is used for the purpose of bleaching clothes in the process of laundry, which gives better results and makes use of lesser amount of water. Second, bleaching of paper. Chlorine gas was used earlier for bleaching paper. These days, hydrogen peroxide in bracket H2O2 with suitable catalyst which promotes the bleaching action of hydrogen peroxide is used. Third, synthesis of chemicals. Ethanol in bracket CH3CHO is now commercially prepared by one-step oxidation of ethene in the presence of ionic catalyst in aqueous medium with a yield of 90%. So CH2 double bond CH2 plus O2 in presence of catalyst PdCu in water CH3CHO 90%. Green chemistry in a nutshell is a cost-effective approach which involves reduction in material, energy consumption and waste generation. Think it over. What is our responsibility as a human being to protect our environment? Some concepts, if followed by an individual, contribute towards a better quality of our environment and human life. Always set up a compost tin in your garden or any other place in your home and use it to produce manure for your plants to reduce the use of fertilizers. Use a cloth bag and avoid asking for plastic carry bags when you buy groceries, vegetables, or any other item. See that all newspapers, glass, aluminium and other items in your area are recycled. We might have to take little trouble to locate such dealers. We must realize that we do not have solutions for every problem, but we can concentrate on issues which we feel strongly about and can do something about. So we should take care to put into practice whatever we preach. Always remember, environment protection begins with us. Summary. Environmental chemistry plays a major role in environment. Chemical spaces present in the environment are either naturally occurring or generated by human activities. Environmental pollution is the effect of undesirable changes in the surrounding that have harmful effects on plants, animals and human beings. Pollutants exist in all the activities and can be controlled. Atmospheric pollution is generally studied as tropospheric and stratospheric pollution. Troposphere is the lowest region of the atmosphere, in bracket approximate 10 km, in which man along with other organisms including plants exist, whereas stratosphere extends above troposphere up to 50 km above sea level. Ozone layer is one of the important constituents of stratosphere. Tropospheric pollution is basically due to various oxides of sulfur, nitrogen, carbon, halogens and also due to particulate pollutants. The gaseous pollutants come down to the earth in the form of acid rain. 75% of the solar energy reaching earth is absorbed by the earth's surface and rest is radiated back to the atmosphere. These gases mentioned above trap the heat which result into global warming. It is important to realize that these very gases are also responsible for the life on the earth as they trap the requisite amount of solar energy for the sustenance of life. The increase in the greenhouse gases is raising the temperature of the Earth's atmosphere, which, if not checked, may eventually result in melting of polar ice caps and consequently may submerge the coastal landmass. Many human activities are producing chemicals which are responsible for the depletion of ozone layer in the stratosphere, leading to the formation of ozone hole. Through the ozone hole, ultraviolet radiations can penetrate into the Earth's atmosphere, causing mutation of genes. Water is the elixir of life, but the same water, if polluted by pathogens, organic waste, toxic heavy metals, pesticides, etc., will turn into poison. Therefore, one should take care to follow international standards to maintain purity levels of drinking water. Industrial waste and excessive use of pesticides result into pollution of landmass and water bodies. Judicious use of chemicals required for agricultural practices can lead to sustainable development. Strategies for controlling environmental pollution can be 1. Waste management, that is reduction of the waste and proper disposal, also recycling of materials and energy. 2. Adopting methods in day-to-day life which results in the reduction of environmental pollution. The second method is a new branch of chemistry which is in its infancy, known as green chemistry. It utilizes the existing knowledge and practices so as to bring about reduction in the production of pollutants.